This is a production of Cornell University.
Okay, so as Tony said, I'm trying for the longest title. We'll see. I think if you look at the schedule, I've got some stiff competition. But let me try to break down the title for about the first half of the talk here. So what are ecosystem services? So here's a definition, but basically, you know, it's jargon, but I think it's useful jargon to help us talk about, we really want a lot of benefits from the land. So from agricultural land, we want more than food. We also want clean water, we want clean air, some people want bioenergy, et cetera. There's a lot of things that we want from the land. Why do I think this is useful jargon? I think it points out that we only pay for some of those things. And surprisingly or not, the things we pay for get a lot more attention than the things we don't pay for. So in economic terms, if we make payments for some of these services that we want that currently aren't being paid for, we bring them within our economic system and they get more attention and hopefully we get more of the things we need from the land. So why pay for reducing nutrient losses? Well, the answer is kind of simple. When we lose nutrients from fields, we can cause water pollution, either local streams, groundwater, or the coastal zone. And most of the coastal zones in the country and many in the world are polluted with excess nutrients. So in the Chesapeake Bay watershed, there have been efforts for decades to reduce nutrient loading, nutrient pollution, and there's still a long way to go. So payments are already being made today to agricultural producers to improve water quality in the Chesapeake Bay. So one of the main focuses we had in this project was looking at the potential to replace some maize in the watershed with switchgrass. The benefit of this is a very large reduction in nitrate leaching and nitrogen to the coastal zone. This research was funded by a regional bioenergy project. So we had a specific interest in looking at the potential for bioenergy in the region. And there's a problem. Bioenergy has trouble competing with fossil fuels due to cost. So natural gas is relatively inexpensive. Biorefineries probably aren't really willing to pay enough to producers for the feedstocks to make the whole system viable. And just to bring in that ecosystem services theme again, if we had a system where we were paying for the carbon pollution from fossil fuels, that would change that equation pretty quickly. But I'm not going to really get further into that topic, but that's one of the motivations for bioenergy. So this gets to why the title is so long, right? It didn't just have bioenergy or switchgrass, but also cover crops, and also nitrogen fertilizer management. Well, maybe these things are in here because I like them, but also I think it makes sense to look at competing options. A lot of research gets done in a bit of a silo, and for a topic like this, there are alternatives, other ways we can reduce nitrogen excess, and I think we should be trying to compare those and see what makes sense. Also, as many of you know very intimately, there's lots of room for improvement in nitrogen fertilizer management, and that's something we should be thinking about in this realm of making payments. So for example, if we're going to make a payment for a cover crop to reduce nitrogen to the Chesapeake Bay, should we pay for if whatever farmers are doing now if they're applying excess fertilizer and causing unnecessary pollution and losing money doing it, should we pay them from that as a baseline to an improved management practice, or should we pay them from, you know, if you are managing fertilizer in a reasonable way, then these other, then a cover crop will have a smaller benefit, right? You've already reduced a good deal of the problem. So that kind of baseline issue becomes important when you get into making payments and sort of the policy aspect. All right, so I like steps, so I got 7 steps in the analysis. I'm not going to read them all because we're going to march through each one here. But in general, what we're trying to do is we need to estimate how much nitrogen is coming from cornfields right now and reaching the bay. And how much could we reduce that with some of these different practices like cover crops or switchgrass or improved fertilizer management. Along the way, we have to get into the economics of switchgrass a little bit because it's not really currently a major crop. So we can't just look at the market to tell us what is the cost to produce switchgrass, what is the price out there. So we actually have to come up with an estimate of what would you have to pay for switchgrass to make it worthwhile for the farmer to produce it. And then in the last step, again, because switchgrass isn't being produced, we can do analyses of what we think makes sense. But if we want to say there's going to be a big increase in switchgrass production, that's going to cause changes in agricultural production. We're competing for land. So we use an agricultural sector model to try to say, OK, we've got some technical potential, but what might happen if you put this in the system we have where with competition for land and demand for other crops. So our general approach, although I'm a modeler, I guess I call myself kind of a reluctant modeler. My training is really in experimental work more so. So we stick with biophysical and economic data whenever we can get it. That's the first place we went to for our methods. And then we're supplementing with models basically when we have to, when there's no other way to do it. Another thing, especially for some of those who know me, we focused on just average values throughout the basin. So this is not a geospatial analysis. So for this first step of nitrogen loading to the bay, we need to know how much fertilizer growers are applying to their fields. And some of you know this is surprisingly hard to get at. So we went to one of our colleagues here, Harold Van Ness, and his lab did strip trials on a bunch of farms and a bunch of years in New York State. And they actually found out what growers are applying to cornfields. So we felt like that was actually one of the better data sources for what people are actually doing. However, the yields of all those strip trials, I think there were 50 site years, the yields were a bit higher than the average yields for maize in the basin. So we took the average grower rate from those strip trials, and we adjusted it downward because of the lower average corn yields in the basin. So the next step, so we also need to know what's the nitrate leaching from cornfields. And again, another benefit of us looking at these ADAPT-N strip trial results is the ADAPT-N model provides a good estimate of that amount of nitrate leaching below the rooting zone. So we have the data, the actual data on yields and on the grower practice, and we have modeled nitrate leaching data. We still have to say, okay, it's a long way from below the rooting zone to the Chesapeake Bay, especially if we look at the northern portions of of the watershed. So there's some losses of nitrogen. And to estimate that, we used some previously published basin-wide models. Okay, so if we replace maize with switchgrass, what kind of a reduction are we going to get? And I want to introduce a little bit of jargon here, nitrogen loading as opposed to nitrogen leaching. So if I don't mix them up, what I'll try to do is talk about nitrogen leaching at a field to mean the amount of nitrogen getting below the rooting zone. Nitrogen loading is used for how much, in our case, how much is reaching the bay. The only tricky part here is sometimes we can talk about nitrogen loading on a per hectare basis, but remembering that there's a little bit of loss in that river system, but we can still sort of allocate the nitrogen load in the bay back upstream to say where it's coming from. So there are a few published measurements of leaching from field studies. And we looked at both with nitrogen fertilizer and without for switchgrass, because some people have been promoting the idea that you should be growing it without nitrogen. Gosh, wouldn't you reduce nitrate leaching even more? Well, the limited field data say, yes, you reduce it, but it's already pretty low. You're only reducing it, you're only getting another kilogram of benefit. So then this cover crop, winter cover crop idea, we also need to quantify what's the benefit of a winter rye cover crop on maize. So for that, again, we went to the literature for field studies that were greater than 1 year, and these were the best studies that we found, and we took the average. So these studies suggest that winter rye cover crop is reducing nitrate leaching about half. So what about nitrogen fertilizer management? So I mentioned that, you know, we think there's a lot of room for improvement there. And again, the AdaptN tool is very helpful here because it's designed to give kind of a best management practice recommendation for the nitrogen fertilizer rate. So for consistency, we can use those same recommendations from that set of strip trials on farms. And again, we can adjust that based on the difference in the higher average yield in the strip trials compared to the average yields in the basin. And then again, the losses from the field to the bay, we use the same method I mentioned, which is basically results of previous basin scale modeling. All right, now we get to talk about money a little bit. So what we were after was, our thinking is, no reasonable producer is going to plant switchgrass instead of maize unless they can get at least equal the profit. So we need to calculate, what does that mean? So we need to know what's the profit that farmers are getting from their maize fields. And any of you who've done this know this is a very sticky area, but we took 10 years of published enterprise budgets from USDA so that if people don't like our numbers, at least we can point to USDA instead of us. And we took the average of that, but adjusting it for inflation. So then we created our own enterprise budget for switchgrass by starting with that maize budget and modifying it. You don't have to plant every year. You know, there's basically less equipment, less fertilizer, et cetera. But we started with the USDA budget to be as consistent as possible with it, and we adjusted things that we knew would be quite different, and we could quantify that fairly well. we also need to know, and so then we could estimate a cost for that switchgrass production, but we have to know the yield in order to do that. And here again, we used a simulation model for a representative site to estimate an average switchgrass yield. We came up just about 10 tons per hectare, which is very close to the average value from a bunch of field trials throughout the Northeast. So it's kind of reassuring, at least, when those things match up. Okay, so what about this idea of payments for nitrogen reduction? As I mentioned, they're already being made, and we focused on Maryland in 2015. They were paying farmers almost $150 a hectare for planting winter cover crops in maize fields on about 200,000 acres. So we took that as, okay, this is at least what Maryland is willing to pay. We used our own calculation of the nitrogen benefit of that practice. So the estimate of nitrate leaching that I mentioned previously, and this per hectare, so the amount, we calculated the amount of nitrogen the amount of reduction in nitrogen loading, so we could come up with how many kilograms of nitrogen per acre is the benefit, and then divide that by into the $148 to come up with $13 per kilogram of nitrogen. So the payment that's being made, we think this is what they're actually getting when they pay that. So we assume the same rate per kilogram of nitrogen reduction, we assume that same rate would apply to switchgrass. Then there's another wrinkle for this idea of growing switchgrass without nitrogen. The problem there is you're getting lower yields because you're not applying fertilizer. So we said, again, you're going to have to make up that cost to make it worthwhile to the grower. So you end up with a higher cost for the nitrogen reduction because you have a lower yield and you have to make up that difference. Yeah, we accounted for that. So we had a separate enterprise budget for switchgrass without nitrogen. You save money on the nitrogen, but you get a substantial yield penalty. So, yeah. And if you've been reading the bottom right of these slides, this won't be the only photo that Jeff Melkonian was kind enough to share with me here. All right, so last step of the methods here. I'm not going to try to read this entire slide. I just want to say, kind of reiterate what I said before. What was our motivation for using an agricultural sector model? And as I said, the motivation is really, if we're talking about hundreds of thousands of hectares of switchgrass production, that's a big change from what's going on now. And it's going to affect, you can't ignore the fact that would presumably increase. If you're replacing maize, then there's going to be a demand for maize, right? That doesn't just disappear. So this model is a way to deal with that issue in a quantitative way. So it models the whole country because that actually makes sense, even though we're interested in the Chesapeake Bay watershed. So this model was run with this change in the Chesapeake Bay watershed, but it's important to look at that in the context of the agricultural sector of the US. All right, so I'll take a little brief pause here and see if there are any more questions or comments about the methods. Tim.
Well, I have a question right from the outset. Why did, you know, I would have guessed that for New York, at least, alfalfa grass mixture would be a good alternative to the maize. Why did you choose switchblade grass?
So, again, the funding for this project was oriented towards bioenergy. And some people have suggested, you know, growing legumes or leguminous mixtures, but there's a lot of problems with that for many types of bioenergy. So we chose switchgrass as kind of a representative crop that's received the most attention as a bioenergy feedstock in terms of the entire logistical chain and conversion chain. So
the rationale there is that maize is a energy crop, at least in part, and so this is an alternative energy crop.
The rationale was we wanted to pick a perennial bioenergy feedstock that might go in place of maize. And yeah, there'd be a whole bunch you could choose. We felt like switchgrass was a good choice if we're going to only have one choice. Maybe, I don't.
I was thinking the same thing as Tim, that of course, in terms of maize in the U.S., what fraction of the U.S. maize production is currently used for bioenergy?
Yeah, I don't have that number, but there is quite a bit, right? So in the Midwest,
the Chesapeake Bay is grown for cows.
Yeah, about half of it at least,
right.
And probably more if you count grain imports, right? I mean, people are growing and selling grain here, but then grain's getting imported into the region.
Yeah, I mean, the thing is, if it was New York, you could encourage farmers to grow alfalfa or alfalfa grass mixture. You may not have to pay them anything because it's just as profitable.
Sure.
As
yeah, so I would agree with that, and I would not say that our goal is not to say planting switchgrass is the best idea of all the possible alternatives. Again, we wanted to restrict ourselves to one bioenergy feedstock, and we chose that one. I think maybe a more useful answer to you and to other folks, and in fact to me as well, we can think about switchgrass as kind of a representative perennial. The nitrogen benefit, the legumes gets a little more complex, but for non-leguminous perennial crops, they're going to have a very similar nitrate leaching to switchgrass. So there's a whole bunch of different perennials that you could grow that would have a similar benefit. And I think, yeah, with the caveat about you have to look a little more closely at the legumes. But yeah.
Kind of following up on that, if your cover crops are reducing nitrate leaching by half on average, and let's set aside where's that nitrogen going for now, and then you optimize nitrogen management on the maize, did you look at that as another option?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. So we looked at that in two ways. One as kind of a potential competitor to the switchgrass idea. So we looked at nitrogen fertilizer, improved fertilizer management and cover crops as competitors to switchgrass. Another good competitor might be, you know, some other mix of a feed, you know, forage. Another wrinkle there is, as I think I mentioned, if you improve the fertilizer management and then you have a cover crop, you know, if you're getting the same proportional benefit, then you're getting less, you're not reducing as many kilograms of nitrogen loading, right? So that's an issue. And that becomes, I think, kind of a policy and management question of how do you want to credit that, and yeah.
Just one more question, just for clarification. Your nitrogen application, does that include winter manure applications on dairy farms? Is this kind of a waste management strategy?
Good question. I love manure, but we stayed away from it for this study. Yeah. Yeah, so we looked at inorganic nitrogen only. We looked at corn, grain production only, not silage. So thanks for bringing that up, because that does, when I talk about kind of corn area and how do we scale up, it's important to know that it's corn for grain only. Okay, so finally some results. So here is nitrogen loading to the bay from some of these options. And again, this is loading, meaning how much arrives in the bay, but then we're looking back upstream and expressing this as kilograms per hectare. So you can sort of think about it at the field scale. So the black bar is our estimate of how much. So saying more than 30 kilograms per hectare of nitrogen are reaching the bay from the average cornfield in the basin. I'll say just the losses in the transport through the watershed obviously vary through the watershed depending where you are, but on average it's not that high. So within the sort of main stem of the river, it's just a few percent on average. And much harder to estimate what's happening between below the rooting zone and the streams. But that's, we think that's on the order of something like 12%. That's one of the more difficult numbers to come up with. So the blue bar is, so it says BMP for best management practice. That's really the adapt-n, applying that adapt-n rate. And this is using a cover crop. In comparison to the average management. So I didn't show, you know. So it's about half. So again, if we use a cover crop on top of the best management practice, it would be down here somewhere, right? And then switchgrass with or without nitrogen is quite low. All right, so how much would you have to pay a grower for a ton of switchgrass, a metric ton of switchgrass, to equal the profit from corn? We came up with $111. And this just shows where this estimate falls in all the other estimates I could find in the literature. Sort of by region of the US. So, you know, we're somewhere in the low end for the Midwest and North Central, and a little bit higher than some of the estimates for the Southeast. Another result here is if we took that $13 per pound of nitrogen payment for the nitrogen benefit of switchgrass, and we multiply that times, or if we express that per ton of switchgrass, it comes out to $24. So that's actually a substantial fraction of that $111 there, right? So the payment that Maryland's making right now is not an insignificant one in terms of the total value of the system here to the grower. All right, so now we scale up to the watershed. This is just a map of the Chesapeake Bay watershed. For those of you who aren't familiar, here's the New York boundary. So Ithaca's right in here, so we actually have the Chesapeake Bay watershed is east and west of us, but not here. And then Pennsylvania has a lot of the agricultural production in the basin, as well as Virginia, Maryland, and Delaware. So this is our estimate of the total achievable basin-wide nitrogen loading reduction. So there is a goal for the bay, which is set based on what scientists think, how much nitrogen needs to be reduced to restore the health of the bay itself. And that's this number here, about 27 gigagrams per year. So how far can we get with some of these different options we've been talking about? Now, in this scaling up, we had to make some assumptions about how much land could you apply these practices on. We made a very important assumption that if lands already had a nitrogen management practice of some kind, based on data from the USDA, we wouldn't apply another one on that land. We did that for simplicity and because we want to make sure we're not double counting, but this is a little bit conservative. There is certainly room for additional land that could have more than one practice on it. But so we're undercounting a little bit. So if you remember, for the maize best management practice for nitrogen fertilizer, it wasn't as big a benefit as the cover crop. So why are they the same here? Anyone want to take a guess? When we looked at the report from USDA about nitrogen management practices, there was more of that land that we thought was eligible for the fertilizer management than for the cover crop. So here's the switchgrass with nitrogen and switchgrass without nitrogen. They're almost the same because you don't get much additional benefit. There's not much more room for improvement. The black bar here is from running that agricultural sector model. So based on our kind of break-even calculation of growing switchgrass, making the same profit as maize, we come up with this amount of area. But running that model that accounts for competition between switchgrass and other crops, we come up with a smaller area of switchgrass. Yeah.
Am I reading that right? If everyone did best management practice on maize, there would be no problem?
No, this is the goal. This is the target. We have to get this much reduction from somewhere. It doesn't all have to come from ag, but it has to come from somewhere. And this is all we can get. So that's substantial, especially because the Adapt-N results suggest farmers can actually increase profits with that. But that's all your, yeah, these are all reductions.
Sorry.
Yeah.
Just a question about the eligibility for the cover crop. So is that based on so many farmers are regrowing cover crops on land? Some of the data that I've seen just said that it's a very small amount of farmers that are actually using cover crops across the nation. The data for the Northeast is a little harder to find.
So this is where we get into sort of data quality and other interesting issues. So we used USDA reports of nitrogen management practices on fields. I can't get the raw data, and it's very hard for me to evaluate the accuracy of those numbers. They don't break things out very well. So I would say, there's a lot of uncertainty about how much land would be available for cover crops. In addition to, you know, I think there's certainly room for multiple practices on the same piece of land. So I guess in brief, what you're saying is, yes, there's uncertainty about what those practices are, how much is actually being done. You know, people may be getting. So this brings up an important issue. If Maryland is paying for 200,000 hectares in 2015, did they get that? And if they did, what did the cover crop look like on all those acres? Did it look good, or, you know, was it planted too late?
And then across in other states too that don't have that payment, I would expect it to be much lower.
So. Yeah. So Yeah, I'll move on here, but acknowledging there's uncertainties here and there's probably room for more improvement than we're listing here. So again, we're jumping back to per hectare here, and this is gross value. So that means what's being paid for the product of that land. So the product is either maize or switchgrass, or we're calling a nitrogen loading benefit, we're calling that a product because the farmer is getting paid for that. So this is not profit, it's how much is being paid for these services, if you will, per hectare. So the maize is the same for all these three because we're assuming that yields are not affected by improving your nitrogen management or by planting a cover crop. Now other people, you know, there's, again, that's an assumption, a simplifying assumption. The benefit, you get paid more for the cover crop, or the value of, there's more nitrogen reduction from the cover crop than there is from the improved management practice. But again, this isn't profit, right? There's even more from switchgrass, but there's, and here, so this gets into kind of how are you going to interpret this price? Who gets the payment? So we set this so that the payment here was the total of the value of the maize production. In other words, we said the farmer's going to get paid this, and then they can sell that switchgrass to a refinery for less than $111. You could also give that payment on top of the payment, right? You could give, so this is a policy question, what you want to do. Again, we set this so that with the idea of the farmer making the same profit as this one right here. So the general point here is just if you're really looking for water quality benefit, you might make a different choice than if you're looking for, you know, maize production or switchgrass production, right? Depending what you're choosing, there's going to be some trade-offs here of which option. And we're not showing farmer profit, but I'm quite confident this is the best one. Dave, did you want to fix something I did here?
Looking back to the previous slide and what you were looking at, gross loss per, I guess, fraction for the whole watershed, is that?
This one?
Small, yeah, right. Maybe the MD, and that's not much of it. Is that the end loading reduction? Is that because there's not many acres or not? I don't know how prevalent corn is.
Yeah, so. So there's a couple of reasons for that. It's on a per hectare basis, it doesn't give you as big a benefit as these other ones, right? A half or a third. And there are more acres that you can apply that to. So these are coming out kind of similarly. But again, I would say there's room for these to go up, again, based on this quality of the data, how many acres are really available. And we were sort of erring on the side of we would rather make a lower total estimate here with a lot of uncertainty rather than a higher one. And one reason for that is, you know, getting people to change their practices, validating, verifying that that's happening, et cetera. There's a lot of challenges besides just kind of an equal profit point. All right, so some concluding thoughts. And based on all the good questions we've had here, you can see why I have thoughts rather than conclusions, right? So I hope we'll have some more discussion about these things. the first point is, this may seem sort of trivial, this $111, but I've been working on bioenergy for more than 10 years, and that's a shocking number to almost everybody who's been involved in bioenergy for all those years. They think that's way high, and I don't. And I've been making this argument for a long time that bioenergy is not going to be viable unless the growers are getting, you know, something that makes it work for them. And there's an incredible mismatch in what people think biorefineries can pay and what they think the cost they can, you know, what they think they can pay a grower. So so the general idea here, you know, we're showing, at least according to our assumptions, yes, there's room to improve the profitability of bioenergy production and improve water quality. There is some room for that. Maybe there's room to meet 11% of that nitrogen reduction goal. But there's other practices that could provide this benefit. So improved nitrogen management and cover crops could provide a little bit greater percentage here. This comparison isn't quite equal because we only ran that agriculture sector model for the switchgrass, but the reason was, with these options, you're maintaining maize production. So we don't feel like we need to run that model, right? We're not changing maize production at all. We're just changing the nitrogen loading. So, you know, this was important to me, even though the funding's from bioenergy. Yes, this idea makes sense, but there are other ideas that kind of look like they may make more sense. They don't necessarily have to compete. We could potentially try all of these ideas, possibly in some combinations, for the maize at least. Lots of other benefits that we haven't quantified. So phosphorus and sediment reduction from planting perennials in place of annuals, wildlife habitat, and again, I mentioned greenhouse gases, not part of our analysis. But that's an important thing to recognize. You know, we had to keep our scope manageable, but it's one of the challenges of getting into ecosystem services is how far are you willing to go? How many of them are you willing to try to quantify? So I mentioned this a little bit. Transaction costs means, okay, Maryland is willing to pay this money, the farmer is willing to accept it, but somebody has to, you know, put it in their pocket and carry it there. And they might have to also sort of look around and see whether they're really going to pay it or not, right? That costs money. We didn't account for those costs. There's also lag times. So an atom or a molecule of nitrate leaving a maize field does not arrive in the bay the next instant, right? It takes weeks or years. So there's going to be a lag time. You start paying the benefits, you start paying for it, the benefits will start to show up over a period of months and years. That's going to be an issue for policymakers. The issue about shifting maize production elsewhere, we handled that by using an agricultural sector model, so at least we formally accounted for that issue. But it's important to remember that just because that economic model said, okay, we can get the system to work and grow some switchgrass, we may have shifted nitrate pollution from the Chesapeake Bay to the Mississippi River Basin, right? So that's another thing to watch out for, is that shifting the problem elsewhere. And we talked a little bit in response to Tim's question. There's lots of other things, lots of other perennials that can be grown, lots of other things that can be done with perennials. So again, our intent was a stand-in perennial, and not that that switchgrass is the only one that should be thought about. So I want to thank Jeff again for photos and also for lots of discussion and help over the years. He's right across the hall and I bother him every day. Shai and Harold were very kind in providing results and data. These are now published, and that'll come up on the next slide. As I mentioned, this was USDA funding for a regional USDA coordinated agricultural project called the Northeast Woody Warm Season Biomass Consortium. Literature cited, I will just point out this last one is basically all of this work is in press, and that should contain all these other citations. So that's biomass and bioenergy. And I'll flip back now to the concluding thoughts and hope we have time for some questions.
Great. Well, let's thank, first of all,
I'm wondering, do we know how distance from the Chesapeake Bay affects the quantity of nitrogen reaching per hectare? In other words, if you're in Maryland, you're a lot closer than you are in New York.
Yeah, so this is...
therefore, it seems like you would want to concentrate on those areas. If there are big differences, you want to concentrate on those areas that are contributing most.
Yeah, so, you know, we obviously don't have any results from this study to answer that question, but yes, it makes a big difference, how close you are to the bay and how close you are to a stream, right? So wherever you are in the watershed, that adjacency to surface water. A lot of other things are going to matter too, like hopefully you're not plowing up and down the hill, right? So the model that we use for the delivery once you reach the river system suggested only about a 2% loss on average throughout the whole basin. Is that correct or not? It's hard to know. there's a literature on this that I haven't written that I've read, but this is based on the Sparrow model, which is a statistical model. People have made measurements of this, but it's tough to make the measurements and integrate them at the basin scale. My guess is that the adjacency to flowing surface water is more important than where you are in the basin. But then there's other things about, you know, the terrain itself. You know, are you getting surface flow? Are you getting flooding? You know, is there a riparian buffer of any kind? All of those things, right? And soil type, you know, how sandy is it? So the sandy soils, the nitrates flowing through them rapidly, et cetera. So I don't know if that helps. Yeah. Yeah, the losses before you reach the stream, you know, are much higher than that. Johannes.
Yeah, thank you, Peter. I was wondering whether you did some sensitivity analysis or error estimates or get a feeling for where there are more improvements, by stacking the different management options or by improving any one of them even further. And if you didn't do that, now what's your gut feeling?
Yeah, so the quick answer is no. You know, our goal was to try to come up with the best average we could. It was a scope question for us.
But you have probably estimates, no? The experiments themselves have probably an error estimate.
Sure.
Some do it better, some do it less good, and then you could compare that with stacking. Is multiple adoption a better pathway, finding ways of adopting multiple best management or improved management techniques rather than trying to improve any one of them even further?
So we talked a little about spatial variation and about nitrogen transport, but obviously that applies, you know, within the field, what gets leached, you know, what's getting volatilized, right? So there's a lot going on within the field that's variable spatially as well, dependent on soil properties and management, cropping system, et cetera. So that said, you know, we didn't try to come up with kind of an optimal mix. I think that to some extent, you know, what you would want to do next to build on this and take it further depends kind of on your starting point. Are you looking to improve profit for the farmer? In that case, the first thing is the nitrogen management, because the Adapt-N results strongly support the idea that you save the farmer money, you increase profit, right? So that seems like a win. Even if we pay to try to make that happen, there's a profit potential there. So that seems like the most obvious thing to do in terms of farmer profitability and getting some nitrogen benefit. You know, from a policy perspective, then I think that should be the first focus. That's one way to look at it. And then, okay, once you've done all of that, you go into, are you interested in cover crops, or are you interested in, perennials? And I think the answer to that is, how concerned are you about shifting, demand? And realistically, nobody should plant switchgrass based on this study, right? Is there a market? Who's going to buy it? You know, this is supporting strategic planning at a multi-decade level. So there's another. I don't know if I'm answering your question at all. There's the uncertainty in the nitrogen management. I think that is being quantified by other people already, Adapt-N and others. That already exists to a great extent. The cover crop benefit, this is pretty simplistic, take an average value from the literature. I'm sure there are many things that can be done to improve a cover crop management, and certainly if you plant it too late and you don't have much of a cover crop, you're not going to get much of a benefit. I don't know if I'm getting at this at all.
No, I was just wondering that your variation that you took the average from, is the variation so large? And it's not just uncertainty and not knowing, but there's
right.
a real variation in the field. Somebody doing it well, somebody
sure.
doing it not well. Is that variation around cover crops so large that it would dwarf whether you can do cover crops plus BNP?
Yeah,
that feeling what's the variation in any one management versus
right.
opportunity to stack two management?
Obviously yeah.
you can't reduce the nitrogen additions to maize and switch to switchgrass, right?
Yeah.
I mean, there are options that don't stack.
Yeah, so
something to stack.
Sure. So let me make a distinction between uncertainty and variability.
Yeah.
So variability would be something that is at least theoretically, at least it should be predictable. It's possible to predict it, right? And uncertainty is kind of irreducible. So the variability we talked about a little bit, right? And some of that, so a next step beyond this would be a geospatial analysis to say where you are is going to affect nitrogen transport, it's going to affect nitrogen leaching, it's going to affect probably a little bit about the cropping system, the growing season, how long that cover crop is there, et cetera. So there's a bunch of variability. A lot is known about that. And you could improve on this estimate by quantifying how some of that variability affects these things. The uncertainty, we haven't tried to do that. Matt might have a better idea on the cover crop side. A big concern I always have, taking an average of a bunch of published studies, this is a bunch of anal retentive grad students out there. At least I hope so. I hope they were. I hope they were doing the best possible job they could on those experiments. And that's just not a luxury that farmers have, even if they are that motivated or have the same mindset. So I always worry when we take, data from the literature, maybe it's the best we have, but we know with yield trials, there's a pretty big yield gap between yield trials for maize in New York and what farmers are getting. And that gap, by my analysis, is growing over the years. So I don't know if we're not doing our job or the farmers aren't, but we're not narrowing that gap. So I worry, I worry about that in this kind of analysis. I worry about that first, I guess. And then, yeah, that and the variability, I think, would answer quite a bit of what you're getting at, maybe.
One, we're past time, but one question.
I was just going to say, I like the analysis, and I think it's really, potentially really valuable to show the problem and how maybe financial incentives could be used to help solve the problem. And then I was, of course, what I would like is what you said, and that's to give the, let's say, the farmers a suite of options that would be qualify them for some kind of incentive payments. But I'm wondering, as you thought about that transfer of payments and so forth, the extent to which it would be necessary to use finance as opposed to, the balance between that and an educational or extension type program. In other words, would people change their behavior if they just knew what the problem is and what they could do to help solve it?
Yeah, so people who do more extension than I do might have an answer for that. I would say in the context of this study, the whole concept of payment for ecosystem services is, yeah, people pay attention when you talk, but when you give them money, they pay more attention, right? So I think that's, and I think the other concept is, if we pay for corn, we're going to get corn, right? If we want improved water quality, we got to figure out how to pay for that. And I don't have the answer about the best way to do it, but by having some things that we pay for and other things that we don't pay for but that we want, that's tough. So there's been a real reluctance to regulate agriculture, so top-down regulation is another approach rather than payments. That's politically usually not very viable, and that's challenging. Even if you pass a law, can you, how do you implement that?
So let's thank Eric Adams.
This has been a production of Cornell University, on the web at cornell.edu.